Welcome to Module 2 of the What Works Clearinghouse Group Design Standards Training. You can access all of the resources mentioned in this module through the WWC's website, whatworks.ed.gov. This module describes the What Works Clearinghouse's process for conducting study reviews. If you haven't already done so, we recommend you view Module 1 in this training series before viewing this module. In this module, we describe the WWC's systematic review process, which is used to identify relevant research studies that assess the effectiveness of an intervention, review those studies against the WWC design standards, and summarize the findings. In this module, we will also describe how WWC reviewers use the handbook and protocols to guide their study reviews. And we will discuss how the WWC determines the research ratings and effectiveness ratings that are used to report on the findings and conclusions from reviewed studies. Finally, we will provide a high-level overview of how the WWC calculates effect sizes during the study review process, explaining how these effect sizes are used to indicate the size or magnitude of an intervention effect. Let us begin by discussing the WWC's study identification and review process. The WWC conducts systematic reviews of research under a variety of topic areas. For example, the WWC reviews research in the areas of literacy, mathematics, and science, as well as research on specific student populations, such as pre-K students in early childhood, K-12 students, post-secondary students, English learners, and students with disabilities. The WWC has developed an overall set of standards and procedures to review education research. These are described in the WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook, available on the WWC website. In addition to these overall WWC procedures and standards, which provide most of the guidance for the review process, each WWC review is guided by the Study Review Protocol, which outlines additional review parameters and procedures. In particular, the Study Review Protocol describes all outcome-eligible domains and the kinds of outcomes found in those domains. For example, the Study Review Protocol provides additional considerations for outcome measures and findings, and a non-exhaustive list of the known independent measures for the math and literacy-related outcome domains. Now, the WWC also uses topic area synthesis protocols for synthesis products, such as intervention reports and practice guides. And these topic area synthesis protocols provide additional criteria that are unique to a given synthesis product, such as the literature search details, guidance on identifying and prioritizing relevant studies for review within a topic area, and guidance on any additional eligibility criteria for the synthesis. The topic area synthesis protocol will also define the outcome measures that are eligible for inclusion under that topic area. These topic area synthesis protocols also define the populations of interest to a review. For instance, a topic area synthesis protocol might require that the set of studies focus on students of a particular age or grade range. The WWC who lead a topic area review effort, including content experts and methodologists, develop these topic area synthesis protocols to ensure that the scope of the review reflects issues and considerations that are relevant to that particular topic area. The study review protocol and topic area synthesis protocols are all publicly available on the WWC website, which ensures the transparency of the WWC's review methods. So what exactly is in the Study Review Protocol version 5.0? Well, this protocol contains a description of all outcomes and outcome domains eligible for WWC review. It also describes any additional considerations needed when considering outcome measures and findings. And the Study Review Protocol includes a non-exhaustive list of all known independent measures for outcome domains where non-independence is a concern.
After we define the scope of our review, the WWC performs a comprehensive literature search for relevant education studies.
The WWC searches a variety of electronic databases and websites to identify relevant studies. Research included in WWC systematic reviews must be publicly available. The WWC defines public in a specific way. Studies and findings must be publicly available, that is, available on the internet with or without a subscription. However, when conducting systematic reviews, the WWC will only search for dissertations and theses in ProQuest Dissertations and Theses Global, EBSCO Open Dissertations, or ERIC, or another database specified in the Topic Area Review Protocol. When conducting its literature searches, WWC review teams work closely with reference librarians to design comprehensive search strategies that follow best practices. These best practices include, for example, developing comprehensive but efficient search strategies and searching a range of database and sources in order to identify all relevant research of interest. WWC review teams provide transparent documentation of the implementation of their search strategy in their topic area synthesis protocols. Appendix A of the handbook includes more details about the WWC's literature search procedures, and topic area review protocols will also contain information about literature searches. And on the WWC website, you can also access previous webinars on the topic of WWC systematic literature searches using the ERIC database. Recall that after the WWC conducts its literature search, it then follows a three-phase process to conduct study reviews. The first phase in this process is screening studies for eligibility. At this stage, WWC reviewers assess whether the studies identified in the literature search meet the eligibility criteria specified in the study review protocol, and, when applicable, the topic area synthesis protocol. The second stage in the WWC study review process is reviewing study findings according to the WWC standards. At this stage, WWC reviewers assess whether those studies deemed eligible for inclusion in the review have findings that meet WWC standards or not. And in the third and final stage of the WWC study review process, we synthesize and report on findings from those studies that do meet standards. We will now discuss each of these three phases in turn. So, after completing the literature search, the first phase in the WWC study review process is to screen and identify studies for eligibility. If a study meets all eligibility criteria, the WWC will proceed to the second stage in the study review. But if a study fails to meet any of the eligibility criteria, the study review will stop at this phase. The WWC uses five broad criteria to assess a study for eligibility. This includes whether the research report itself is eligible, meaning was it publicly available, written in English, and did it report on findings within an eligible time frame, the last 20 years. And the WWC also assesses whether the study used a research design eligible for review. The WWC also assesses whether the study included an eligible participant sample, whether it examined an eligible intervention, and whether the study measured at least one outcome from an eligible outcome domain specified in the protocol. Remember that all eligible outcome domains are found in the study review protocol. Let us clarify here how the WWC defines a study, since WWC reviews of research are done at the level of a study. The WWC defines a study as an examination of the effect of an intervention on a group of participants in which assignment to conditions was coordinated. So a research manuscript may contain findings from a single study or may contain findings from multiple studies, such as reports of multiple investigations with unique samples. Likewise, one study may have its findings published across multiple manuscripts, such as by reporting on findings from different cohorts in the sample in different manuscripts. It is common for the WWC to review two or more manuscripts that assess the same intervention and use the same sample. For this reason, the WWC must establish whether findings from multiple manuscripts addressing the same intervention should be classified as the same study or as multiple studies. In order to make this determination, the WWC review team will assess sample overlap to establish whether the study samples under consideration are independent or not. If the samples overlap, the WWC will treat those findings from overlapping samples as multiple effects from the same study for the purposes of synthesis. So how do WWC reviewers assess sample overlap? Well, first, the WWC defines samples in terms of their units of analysis, which is often students or teachers. When assessing sample overlap, review teams then compare a range of characteristics across the sample in question. This includes the full references of manuscripts, as well as up to 7 of the authors of the manuscripts and their open researcher and contributor IDs, or sometimes pronounced as either ORC, IDS, or ORCIDS, like the flower. Review teams will also assess the intervention name, the year when participants received the intervention, the years when outcome data were collected, the location of the research, the grade level of the participants, and the number of participants in the sample. If the contents of some of these characteristics for a manuscript overlap with or are the same as those of another manuscript, the review team may query the authors to determine whether the studies might have overlapping samples. And again, if the samples overlap, the WWC will treat the findings from the overlapping sample as multiple effects from the same study for the purposes of synthesis. Let us consider a few scenarios to help clarify how the WWC defines a study. First, consider a manuscript that presents a finding based on combining data across related samples, such as those from multiple time periods within the same school. For example, imagine that researchers randomly assigned classrooms to conditions within a middle school in Ohio, and the same intervention is implemented in the intervention classrooms over 3 school years. The study examines the effectiveness of the intervention in these 3 consecutive cohorts of students in the middle school. Let's say the authors use the same analytic approach to estimate the effects of an intervention over 3 years, separately by each year, and then combined across all 3 years. The study then reports on these findings in a single manuscript. This example is relatively straightforward. Although the individual cohorts are reported separately, they are also reported together and can be reviewed as a single study. Now, imagine that instead of reporting the results from the 3 cohorts in a single manuscript, what if the authors released a series of manuscripts, each which reported on the findings for each year? In each manuscript, the authors report that they have added the successive year's cohort to their impact analysis for the effect of the intervention.
This means that the samples across the 3 studies are overlapping because all 3 manuscripts have some sample overlap. Even though these results were reported in multiple manuscripts, the WWC would review the series of manuscripts as a single study. The fact that the authors released the findings separately in these different reports does not affect how the WWC reviews the findings. Again, the major consideration for whether findings for multiple manuscripts addressing the same intervention should be classified as the same study depends on whether the WWC establishes whether sample overlap is present.
Another common example is for a single study to be published in multiple reports. For example, study authors might randomize student classrooms into intervention and comparison groups to examine the impact of an intervention. The researchers might then describe the results of this study in a conference paper a journal article, and a technical report posted publicly on the internet.
In this case, the sample of students is the same in all three publications, so this would constitute a single study.
Now, one additional consideration that is worth mentioning is how the WWC defines a study in the case of blocked or multi-site studies. For blocked or multi-site studies, the WWC will consider block or site-specific effects reported in separate manuscripts to be different studies. If block or site-specific effects are reported in one manuscript, the WWC will consider it a single study. Now that we have clarity on how the WWC defines a study during the first phase of the review process, let us discuss the second phase of the process, which entails reviewing study findings according to WWC standards. So any eligible studies that were identified in phase 1 advance to the second phase in the review process. At this phase, the WWC examines several features of the study to determine whether the study's findings can be attributed to the intervention. The WWC performs this review process separately for each outcome, and then aggregates the findings at the domain level for each study to determine study-level research and effectiveness ratings.
As will be described in greater detail in the remainder of this training series, when the WWC is reviewing the findings from eligible studies against the WWC's group design standards, a key consideration is whether the study used individual level or cluster level assignment.
Individual level assignment studies are defined as those where individuals, such as individual teachers or students, are assigned to study conditions. In contrast, cluster level assignment studies are those where groups or clusters of individuals, such as classrooms, schools, or districts, are assigned to conditions as intact units. This concludes the second module in the WWC Group Design Standards training. Let's review what we discussed in this module. We described each of the steps in the WWC study review process. We then explained how the WWC determines research ratings for study findings, and how the WWC then determines a study level research rating. We also described how the WWC determines effectiveness ratings. And finally, we provided a high-level overview of how the WWC calculates effect sizes during the study review process. Remember that you can access all of the resources mentioned in this module on the WWC website, whatworks.ed.gov.